Everybody, welcome to live stream number 48. I think I am streaming now. I hope you gotta hit the. I think we are. You gotta hit the right button. Hey, thank you so much for joining me today for live stream number 48. Today is Monday. We made it, folks. We made it through the weekend. I hope you had a great weekend, and we're back at it here. It's the 21st, 2017. Here in the United States, it's all about the solar eclipse happening. Just let you know that here in upstate New York, not really much to see here about 30 minutes ago. But if you're new to these live streams, let me just introduce myself. My name is Lars Christensen. Thank you so much for taking the time. These live streams are about 20, 30 minutes long, pretty much attacking topics that are requested by you guys. So down in the description area, you'll find my email address, lars.christensen@autodesk.com. Shoot me an email if there's anything specific you would like to see in these live streams. Today's topic is an intro into sculpting. You can see we already got a few people coming in here. We got Tomi from Finland. Thank you so much. We got Joe, Michael. Just really appreciate all you guys taking the time out of your busy days to join. I will get back in and chat with the guys in the live stream a little bit later, but let's dive right in here, fresh on a Monday, and let's talk a little bit about sculpting. So, let me switch over here to Fusion, so you should see that. So, I really just want to spend like 3 minutes talking about the basics, because I think that this is important, especially if you're not brand new to... or if you are brand new to CAD. So if you watch any of the previous live streams, we have really worked a lot inside of this modeling workspace. And that's where we're doing kind of like parametric modeling. You define everything with sketches and lines and arcs and dimensions. And you create a mechanical model. Now, so a mechanical design, like think of like your motor or like all the bits and pieces in your power plant that makes energy, all those are very like straightforward, square, accurate dimensions, holes. But then at some point in kind of like the evolvement of CAD history, there were certain people who started talking about that they needed to be able to do more complex shapes. So most consumer products that you're looking at, they are maybe not so accurate in the dimensions, but they are very, the appearance, how the curvature is and things like that is important. And that's where this sculpting come in. Now, if you watch some of the other live streams, you'll see we have worked a little bit in the patch environment, so surfacing in here. Well, today we're going to talk about sculpting. What is these? I'm going to kind of like give you some of the tools that I hope can get you going with the sculpting environment. Some tips and tricks. Now, the sculpting don't have its own workspace by default. You actually activate it right up here. You can activate it up here on this little icon in the model environment. Now, as soon as you click on it, it will let you know that you have entered the sculpt environment here. And then you will now see that now I actually have a sculpt tab. Why is that? Well, it's really because the sculpt and the model environment do really work hand in hand, because the default when we are done with the sculpt environment is that we will hit finish form. That's going to turn our sculpt environment, our sculpt body, back into a solid body that we can work with. So I hope that this somewhat makes sense. So the model, think about it like, maybe this would kind of help. Think about like any consumer product that you buy, maybe the outside of it, like a vacuum cleaner, has some very smooth surfaces on it, that'll be sculpting. But all the mechanical stuff inside of it, the motor and all the other things, that will be in the model environment. All right, I hope that helps a little bit. let's jump in and let's talk about today's kind of like thing. So many times when CAD companies are doing kind of like demonstrations, they find some really fancy models to kind of impress the viewers. And that's part of what I do for a living. But for these live streams, I like to just kind of like look around my house and try to find something to use. Well, I like food. So looking for something that is somewhat, curvature and have these complex shapes. I looked at my cereal spoon this morning and I said, you know what, let's try to do somewhat of a spoon. Now, I'm going to try to keep this short. These live streams are meant to be about 30 minutes or less. So I might not make the perfect spoon, but my hope is, and you give me the feedback down in the description area, that at the end you have seen some of these sculpting tools that can help you attack your stuff. So I found this image over here because you can see I just went out on Google and I searched spoon, and I was looking for a side and a top view. So I took this image here. Let me just call that up so you can kind of like see it. So that's just a JPEG of that. And then I actually just kind of like screen captured out the top, and I screen captured out the side of it here. And the reason I did that was that many times, not all the times, but many times when you're doing sculpting, you're kind of like doing a reference dimensions. You're not really working, like when we're working in the normal model environment in here, we are very accurate, right? We're talking very about like, you know, we're making things perpendicular and parallel. But inside the sculpting area, you can kind of, maybe times you're just making things somewhat close. Now I'm going to start in the model environment though. So I'm going to start a sketch on the side here. And I like to do this as kind of like helping myself. What I'm going to do is I'm going to create a center rectangle, and I'm going to give it kind of like a size of what my overall spoon just about is going to be. So I write 1 by 6 inches. Might be a big spoon, I don't know. But that's kind of like the work area for my spoon. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up under Insert, and I'm going to say Attach Canvas. And I'm going to bring these two side views in and use them as a reference for this sculpting. So I'm going to click Attach Canvas, and I'm just going to select a face here. So I'm going to select the side face here. And then I'm going to select my image, and that's going to be the side of the spoon here. Click that, hit Open. And that actually comes in here. Now let me just go up and click the front here on the view cube, and you can kind of see this the spoon kind of coming in here. Now, you hopefully are somewhat familiar with these handles. If not, you will get very familiar with them doing sculpting. Now I'm going to click this one here and just flip the direction of the spoon here, because in my mind I want it like this. And I can scale things up and down. And what I'm trying to scale the spoon up to be somewhat close within the rectangle that I modeled up. I think that is probably close enough for what I'm going to try to do here. And I'm going to hit OK. Now, don't forget that this video will be recorded and be up on YouTube. So if you need to rewatch it again, you know, if I'm going a little too fast, just do that. Now, I'm going to insert also the top of the spoon. So I'm going to go back in an Attach Canvas. I'm going to rotate my view a little bit. And I'm going to click on the top face here and click on the top of the spoon. Like that. I'm going to go on the top view. So you see, I'm going to use the view cube quite a bit. You can see the spoon is actually coming in the wrong way. So I'm going to rotate it around 90 degrees. And I can also make it a little bit bigger. Now I'm going to go kind of like in an isometric view here. Just to kind of trying to, whoops. Control Z is undo. So you can always do that. Select the image. Top of the spoon. I said I want to rotate it around here. Make sure you grab the right handle. And let me grab it here and make it a little bit bigger. And I'm just trying to make that spoon somewhat to the same size as my size view here. The close I can get. That's a little small still, a little bit bigger. So, I mean, this is where if you if you're really trying to do something accurate, you'll probably spend some more time on this. But this is good enough for me. I'm gonna hit okay to that. So what I have now, I can hide my scat. So what I have now is the side view of the spoon, kind of like with the top view of my spoon resembled here. And again, you don't have to have this for doing sculpting, but many times you will use something like a reference for this. So I hope this makes sense. All right, sculpting. So now we're gonna go up and click create form, and it will bring us into this sculpting area. And it actually gives me a warning that says, you're entering the sculpt environment, use the finish button to return to solid modeling. So like I said before, we're gonna hit this finish button in the end, that's gonna turn into a solid. So the sculpting area is, this area in here is really just kind of like a temporary workspace, you could maybe say. So if you watched some of my other live streams, you saw how I used surfaces in some of them. And I talked about how surfaces is like non-thick face, almost like blankets that you can move around. And T-splines is this kind of the same idea. It has no thickness. You're gonna have to add thickness to it in the end. So that's one thing to remember. But where in standard modeling and in with surfaces, you will normally use like sweeps or lofts. You use these commands to kind of like create things. Inside with the sculpting, we're really just dragging corners, edges, and surfaces. So as you will see here as I'm going over it. So you would get very familiar with these, with a command called edit form. Well, you can now start pulling and dragging. Now there's two tools I'm gonna show you that I prefer to use when I'm using sculpting. And you go under create. One is these predefined forms, so box, there's some cylinders, spheres, and different kind of pre kind of creates places. But then later on, I'm going to show you another one where we're just breaking it down to an individual face or blanket. Okay, so just remember that there's kind of like you start with something. Now, because a spoon, if you're looking at the bottom of the spoon, it kind of like has a sphere kind of curve down here. I'm actually going to start out with a standard sphere. So I'm gonna click sphere, and it's gonna create a new body. And you know bodies like solid body, but this is actually like a sculpting body. It's also called T-spline. That's actually kind of like the technology behind this. I'm just gonna select the face, and then I'm gonna select the center point here, just to place it, boom. Just like that, and you will now see that I have this sphere, and I can actually control diameters. I can do kind of like different things with it right here, but I'm just going to go ahead and hit okay. It's really not important right now. Now let me just go up on the light bulb and turn off my canvas. So here you kind of like just have this ball, and it looks very smooth, but be aware that it's made up of faces. So normally when you see me working, we're working with shaded, with visible edges turned on. And as soon as I turn that on, you will see that, yes, it's made out of faces. So my canvas is back on, so we can kind of like see where we are in space. So this is just a ball sitting right here without any mass in it. It's not a solid ball, like, you know, solid modeling. It's really just a no thickness wall ball. And if I go over here, and you will see that in the bodies folder, it's sitting as this T-spline body over. And I can select it just like we can with a solid. Now, if I right-click with it highlighted, and I click Edit Form, and this is one of the things you're going to see me use a lot, I get these handles showing up. And these handles, you should really get familiar with these handles. So you can move it up and down, along the axis, up and down. We can scale things up and down. And by the way, anytime you're working inside of the sculpting environment, Control Z is undo, and is really a good friend in here that I use a lot. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go over here, and I'm just gonna place this ball somewhat close to our reference dimension with the bottom of this curve, somewhat around here. And I'm just going to hit OK to get out of this area. One of the neat tricks to know, if you ever are using these create shapes, the rectangle, the sphere, and these kind of pre-made shapes, is that you're actually allowed to then delete the ones, this part of the shape you don't want to. So if I go up on the top view up here, and I'm just going to do a window, well, it's going to select everything you can see from the top. It's not going to select the bottom. You can see that that is unselected. Now, if I just hit delete on my keyboard, I kind of like just took that sphere and I just blew half of it away somewhat. That is a perfectly legit way to use these bodies. You don't have to bend them all into shape before you start, you know, working with them. Getting right out of the gate and just deleting kind of the shapes that you don't really need, the top of it, perfectly good. So I just did that. I just deleted that. Now, another thing that you should know about, hide the canvas again, is that, like I said before, we're going to be pulling in faces. We're going to be pulling in edges and points that we can actually add a really cool tool in here called symmetry. If you're familiar, you're probably familiar with symmetry if you watch some of my live streams. And what I can do is I can make sure that I don't have to select both halves. So I just have to select one half of the spoon and the other half will kind of like follow that symmetrical. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit mirror up here, and I'm going to select two faces, and then the software is going to create a green line right through there that shows me where the symmetry is. So I'm going to select one and two, so one on each side, and you will see that I get a green line going right through there telling me the symmetry, and that line goes right through where my canvas kind of like goes to. So that was very handy. Okay. It just means that now, if I'm working on the front view here, if I'm selecting these two faces right here, they have now also been selected over on the back side of the spoon, just making my life a little bit easier. Now, how do I select those faces? I literally just click, hold down Control, and click the next face, and that gets highlighted. And now I'm actually just ready to start pulling in things. So I'm going to right click and hit edit form. And this handle shows up. And you've already seen me use that handle to move things around. And now I can actually start just moving the same shape here. So now I'm kind of like pulling in those two surfaces what is actually pulling in the rest of the shape. So right now, I'm kind of like underlying the bottom shape here. And when I'm done here, if I don't have to hit OK every time inside of this edit form. I can just click out in space, like we use the inspection tool, and it deselects everything. And then I can just select the next thing I want to move. Select that face. But remember, it's selecting the face in the background, too. And I can start moving that kind of like out like that. So just like this, I'm already starting to move that whole, by selecting those four faces, as you can see, we're kind of like, let me turn the canvas off. I'm kind of like starting to pull these faces in the direction I want them to go, following kind of like this canvas. Like I said, I can also select edges. So I can select this top edge here and hold down Control, select the next edge. And I can start pulling in those edges, what will pull in other geometry kind of like going along here. So that gives me an option to kind of like pulling this shape out here. Hit out in the white space to kind of like deselect. I can even go up and select a point, and I can kind of start pulling in points if I want to kind of like create this. And don't forget, Control Z will always bring you kind of back to where you were. So this tool, selecting faces, holding down control and start pulling can kind of give you a way to kind of like pulling edges towards where you kind of want them. And you can actually also move this triad if you want to. So if I go over and I click on this little set pivot, I can change the pivot point. So maybe this intersection, hit the green check mark, and now I'm pulling from that point across. So I hope that this kind of helps to kind of like see how we can kind of like pulling things towards where we want them. We can always click out in the white space. We can select multiple edges here, and we can kind of like stretching them down to, if we want to, kind of like trying to adjust each of the faces to where we kind of want them to kind of be. So I hope that this is kind of helpful to see how I'm kind of like just pulling this shape somewhere where I think I want it. Now, as soon as I got something like this, I might hit OK and then just kind of recess what I got so far. And turn the canvas off can make it a little bit easier. And you should be aware of that when you are pulling and in all these shapes, you could kind of like accidentally overfold them, and it might not show you. There is a utility in here where you can try to repair bodies, but the easiest way to actually find out if you have an issue is by, this is just me, that might be a better way, hit finish form, and it will take you back into the model environment, and then just hit Control Z to go back again. This is a good way to kind of like check it as you are moving away here. Now let me go up to the top view up here, and let's just take a look at the spoon from up here. So I can see up here that, all right, we're pulling towards these edges. Let me go down here and control select these two edges, maybe right click, edit form, and you know, maybe we can try to pull out a little bit in those. So I hope that this kind of like gives you an idea about how we can try to kind of like pull things in a direction of what we kind of want. So here, I maybe want to try to select these two edges, right click, edit form, and kind of try to pull this back like this. Hit on the white space, maybe just select this face, and we can maybe move that over. You know, I think you're getting kind of like what I'm getting at here, kind of like pulling this blanket in the direction. And now if I went up to the top, I could see that I could maybe pull this in a little bit. I think you kind of get the idea. And don't forget, like I said, my trick is to hit finish form, make sure I don't get any arrows, and if I don't, Control Z to go back in again. Okay, I gotta move a little bit faster here. So, and don't forget, this is being recorded, so you can always review it again. Now, another tool I wanna show you is, like I said before, it's actually creating faces can be just as helpful here. So what I'm actually going to do is, because I've only been sketching on the origin, now I'm actually going to create a offset plane, and you should be familiar with this already. If you watch my live streams, you can create an offset plane. So kind of like creating a plane up, and I'm just going to try to align it somewhat close with this edge of where our end of our spoon is kind of just about there. Now, so you can create faces. So let me just say I want to do a face right on that top face there. And what I can do is just sketch up a rectangle like that. And I'm just going to hit OK. And I'm going to turn my origin off. And now this is just a flat piece, one little, I don't know, piece of skin, like you see over here, but it's completely flat. And you can actually work with that. Now, if I just grab an edge and right click and hit edit form, I can of course drag it just to make it longer. But a neat trick is, because I know that it's gonna change shape around here, right? Because it's gonna kind of like go out there. I can drag it out to where I think it's gonna start changing shapes. And if I hold down the Alt key, now this is important, Alt key, and then drag, I'm actually creating a new section from that. And I can continue doing that. I'm just holding down the Alt key. I can literally continue to create out new segments like that. So now I just have a flat piece, but it has these different segments in here. We're just gonna make it a little bit easier. So like when I select this edge here, if I, and you should get familiar with some of the different pulls, not just the arrows, but if I can, I can actually also make this wider by dragging right here. I could go in and select this edge in here and kind of like do the same. So that gives me a way to adjust this. That's one trick you should know. Another thing you should know, let me get out of the edit form. If I just select an edge over here, because one of the things I know is that this spoon is kind of like going narrow and then become fat again. You can also insert these lines manually. So if I select an edge and right click, you can insert an edge, and that will actually let you insert, you see there in green, an edge that will let me select that one. And now I can grab that edge, right click on it, hit edit form. And now I can kind of like make that a little narrow to kind of like resemble how the spoon is kind of coming together. So that is a couple of important form tools to kind of know about. Now, the other thing that I want to show you is that right now we have two different bodies. We have the spoon and we got the handle kind of thing here. There is also some different ways we can join them together. One of them is calling bridging. Let me just go into the top view here for a second. Another thing, so I showed you how you can divide, insert a line by right clicking. You can actually also select on one of these faces. Well, let me select on the one in the over here, because that's the one I've been working on. And you can also subdivide faces. So I just blew that one surface in to multiple surfaces, so you can work with those. So I can, so just be aware of, you can split these surfaces up too. Just by right-clicking on a surface, you can create a subdivide in there, and you can do all kinds of things. So with that in there, I can go up and use this bridge, and I'm going to select one edge, and then I'm going to select these two other edges here, and I'm breaking my symmetry right now with this command. But that's okay. And I can actually go in and create kind of like that bridge between these two sides here. And I can actually show how many connections I get here. Let's just create maybe two. Hit okay. And you will see that it creates a bridge. Now it comes up in red, giving me a warning that this is not working with the symmetrical right now, because I didn't create one half. But now I just connected those handles together with that bridge. Now again, like I said before, be aware of that shapes don't kind of like crumble up on one another. Now if they do, we could of course just go in again and select these faces here, right click, edit form, and we could kind of like just maybe pull things out a little bit if we needed to. All right, so what we did when we bridged these two together, we actually created, we got back to one body. I hope this is useful. So this is not the prettiest spoon, but you know what you can do in 30 minutes. Now when we have this together, now we can actually go in and add some thickening to it. So just like you would do if it was a surface body, we can now go in and add some thickening it. So I'm going to go in here and select the whole thing here. Now there's some different options to the thickness type. I'm going to select soft here, and I can kind of like create some thickness. And I don't know how big this spoon is. I don't know. I'm just going to put something in here. Hit OK. And now this got thickness to it. So now it's got about 20 thousandths thickness. I keep on getting the warning about symmetry because that's still turned on. That's fine. But be aware of that even though that I now thickened it. Now, normally when you work with surfacing, when you have thickened something, you're kind of like at the end. But with the sculpting environment, I can actually now go in here, because if I turn my canvas on, I actually know that I don't have any thickness to my handle here, that I can actually go in and just select a portion and do the same we did before. I can right click, hit edit form, and then I get again tools where I can start adding, I can actually start adding some thickness to this thing. Now I might have to work a little bit of the connection down here. But as you can see, I can start adding thickness to this, and I can add, you know, I can select different regions in here. It's probably easier on the front view here. So let's just select this, and I can add extra thickness to that portion. Let's turn the canvas back on again. And maybe I want to move it down a little bit, a little bit of curve to it, move it down like this, add a little bit of more thick. You get what I'm trying to do here. Hit OK. And I've actually added that thickness to the part here. Like I said, the connection is very thin in here. But when you're done with all this, you can go ahead and hit Finish Form, and you now end up with a full solid body, just like if we had, you know, modeled it up inside of Fusion with other things. So I don't know, this spoon looks a little bit like something somebody made in a prison or something like that. But turn the shader on, it looks a little bit less crazy. But I hope that this gave you a good entry in 30 minutes into the sculpting workspace. At least, you know, if you're brand new in this, I went way too fast. I'm sorry. I'm trying to keep these somewhat short. Rewatch it. It's going to be up as soon as I hit stop to the streaming. It's going to be about 20 minutes, and it will be right back up on YouTube for you to watch. So I hope this was useful. A couple of things that I think is important. If you are subscribed, and if you haven't, I would really appreciate if you would, and you have the notification on, you should have seen that for this entire week, I did put in all the times for this week. So thank you to Paul for this week. So tomorrow, same time, all the time for the week, we're going to talk about the inspection dropdown. Wednesday, we're going to talk about, that's number 50. We've done 50 live streams. We're going to talk about water jet, laser plasma. Thursday, we're going to talk about really cool right-click menus inside of Fusion Cam. And Friday, we're going to do a beginner of how to zoom, pan, rotate. I need to do that. So if you already know how to zoom and rotate, you know, Friday's probably all good. But I hope that that you got those, because people have been asking me for that. Also, like I said earlier, down in the description area, you can find my email address, lars.christensen@autodesk.com. Definitely any future topics that you have in there, definitely appreciate that. Another thing I'm doing this week, because we're going to hit number 50, 50 live streams, next week, I'm probably not going to live stream. I'm going to San Francisco next week. That is where Autodesk headquarters is. And I'm going to meet with my boss and also my boss's boss. And actually, one of the things we're going to talk about there is this whole live stream. Now, where we've done like over 50 of them, you know, how are they? Is it something that works? So if you have any opinions about these live streams, if you think that they're just being stuffed down your throat, or if you think that they're super good and they're kind of like helping you, I'll definitely invite you to send me an email. Don't go down the description area, lars.christensen@autodesk.com. I would love your opinion about these live streams, how it's working versus the more polished videos. I'm going to do what I normally do. I am going to end the broadcast right now and jump into the live stream. We had about 54 people in there, and say hi to everybody and see if there's any questions or just anything that is going on. So until, well, tomorrow, if you have the time, I really appreciate you joining in. And until the next time, have an awesome, awesome day. Thank you so much.